Okay, folks, welcome to our Delta Waterfowl Hunting 101 webinar tonight. You can see all the topics there we'll be going over, and I'll move into our next slide. Tonight's panelists obviously includes myself, and if you've attended any other of these, you know who I am, the Hunter Engagement Coordinator for WRC. And tonight we have Jacob Bushaw, Field Research Manager for Delta Waterfowl. We are the only ones here tonight, so I'm sure you'll still enjoy it. We have lots of information to cover. As you know already, webinar overview, it is one length. Yeah, it is one length. That is 1 hour. It will be recorded and distributed in less than or equal to 2 weeks. A little slow getting them back, but you will receive it. And then they will also be placed on our WRC YouTube page with all the other webinars. There will be a Q&A at the end, 30 minutes long. And that again is in writing only. We won't be talking except for me narrating the questions, topic specific and addressed during the Q&A only, not during the webinar. The chat or hand raising will not be monitored tonight. It's going to be just Jacob and I. Any enforcement questions will be forwarded if applicable. I'm not enforcement. We may have some comments available maybe when Jacob's covering some things, but sometimes the enforcement questions get a little bit deeper. But again, they will be forwarded if needed. Please allow us to cover the material before writing the questions. A lot of times folks will ask questions right up front, and that's actually material that's going to get covered. And again, thanks for joining us tonight. We're glad you're here. As you know, if you've heard this before, I'm the person that talks about this U.S. Fish and Wildlife Survey done every 5 years. Obviously, the 2022 version is well behind, but it's going to be coming in 2023. And the bottom takeaway is this. Between 1975 and 1980, we were 17.1 million strong. About 8 to 10% of the population hunted. By 2016, we're down 11.5 million. And again, these are national numbers, not just per state. So we've had this precipitous decline. And again, as you know, hunting pays for conservation, but it's also part of a popular pastime that we have. And it's a reason why I have a job, and many other states have R3 coordinators as well. Looking at North Carolina a little bit closer, our license holders continues on an incline. And as we've discovered, the lifetime licenses are very popular. People get them, and usually for infants that sometimes don't even use them. So what we really do look at is active participation. And you can see, as compared to license holders, active participation is less than half. And roughly in 2021, it was about 300,000 hunters actively participated. This cohort here that you can see up along that initial line before it dropped really represents the baby boomer generation of hunters. Or as I like to say, the greatest number of modern day North American hunters of all time. And we are aging out. I'm part of that boomer group. And in fact, where they start aging out there at around 63 or so, that's how old I am. I'm still chugging along. But the reality is this is a group that is going to leave a big gap in conservation. And many of the people that come to us, whether these webinars or workshops that I'm involved in, are a niche market that we're trying to work with. We don't ever expect to get back to the numbers we once had, but we just want to maintain hunting and keep it alive. So, and looking at it another way, as compared to the overall North Carolina population as a whole, you can see the number of active hunters and the license holders looks quite small. And in fact, there, as of 2021, as I indicated, 300,000 hunters, the population during that time was 10.6 million. So if you look at hunters' overall population, remember, as compared to the overall population, 1975, 1980, 8-10% hunted, even 2016, 4-5, were less than 3%. So the point is, this isn't only about conservation funding, it's about a pastime that we all care about, in a connection, an intimate connection with an activity we love. Obviously, I'm involved in hunting webinars. They are designed for both the novice and experienced, what you're seeing tonight. And as I often say, it's very easy to transition a deer hunter to a turkey hunter, or a deer hunter to a squirrel hunter, or vice versa via a webinar, because they already know the basics of hunting, like say shooting firearms, or using tree stands, or scouting, or game recovery. Well, the GSOs, that is an in-person web workshop, that provides the very basics to individuals that need it. And that's primarily people, excuse me, that have never hunted, have minimal experience, lack social support for hunting, and also for lapsed individuals, maybe that haven't hunted for a long time, and especially haven't hunted big game. The reality is they are experiments to offset participation decline. Whether they work, only time will tell. Another thing that we've been involved in is promoting. We have many people that are interested in programming, or as I like to say, many wanting, but not as many, you know, willing. And so always trying to build volunteer instructors and of course landowners, for example, to host those GSO workshops. And we recently did an article in our magazine, it's in this month's issue, that promotes one of our gold standards out in Gastonia, the landowner and the conservation partners involved. So we're hoping to build that. Obviously, Jacob will be going over some regulation related information, but as I like to say, the regulations digest is something that you should have or get. And I even say, take it into the restroom. You got to go there anyway, because that's where the majority of the information you need, you're going to be able to get. And as I usually tell people, do your due diligence by looking at regulations digest. And as I also like to say, let your fingers do the walking first before you go hunting. That way you're prepared. With that, I am going to stop sharing and we're going to pull Jacob up. Take it over, my friend.
Hey guys, I hope everybody can see my screen. If you can't, please throw something in the chat and let me know. Or if you can't hear anything. So my name is Jake Bushaw, as Deet said. I am Delta Waterfowl's field research manager. So today I kind of wanted to go over with you guys Delta Waterfowl's Duck and Goose Course 101. So when Deet first approached me about giving this webinar, I was working on different ways we could lay out and talk about it. And I realized that we already created a course that's going to cover more so what I talk about today anyway. So I kind of wanted to give you guys and just run through this course with you. The benefit of this is it covers a lot of variety of topics and it's available to you guys at any way, shape or form. It's got great videos, text, stuff like that. So it can be an extremely useful course for you guys moving forward. That being said, I'm going to start this off with playing this short video clip for you guys. If for some reason you can't hear it, please let me know.
Welcome to Delta Waterfowl's Duck and Goose Hunting 101 course. I'm Joel Rice, part of the Delta team. We're really pleased that you decided to learn more about waterfowl hunting through this online class. Though you may not have been duck or goose hunting yet yourself, that's fine. We're looking forward to being your guide in this adventure. There are more than a million waterfowl hunters in North America, and there are just about as many reasons why they love duck and goose hunting. Here are just a few. Waterfowl hunting is nearly universal. 49 states and all the Canadian provinces have seasons. There are many species of ducks and geese. Setting a goal to hunt all of them can become a lifelong pursuit. In waterfowl hunting, you make the action happen. The birds respond to the way you set your decoys, your calling, and how well you hide. If you really get into waterfowl hunting, it can become a lifestyle, not only during the hunting season, but year-round. There's so much to it. In some types of hunting, you are only allowed to harvest one animal per season. But in waterfowl hunting, generous limits on many kinds of ducks and geese allow you to be successful, yet hunt again and again throughout the season. And then there's dogs. Once you've hunted with a good dog, it may become the main reason for you hunting. Because ducks and geese are hunted in so many places, you'll get to experience a wide variety of terrain and hunting challenges. Every day is something different. Waterfowl hunting is the most social kind of hunting there is. When sharing a blind, you'll get to laugh, joke, and share memories with family and friends. Whether you like traditions or technology, duck and goose hunting offers plenty of both. Through this Delta Waterfowl Duck and Goose Hunting 101 course, you'll see that these are just a few of the things that make waterfowl hunting so great. As you go through these units on basic duck and goose hunting skills, remember that Delta Waterfowl and its members are only a mouse click away. Just go to www.deltawaterfowl.org and you'll find information and support that will help ensure that you enjoy your first hunt and every hunt. Let's get going.
Okay, so just kind of wanted to show you guys that clip as an introduction. So what this kind of boils down to is, and why waterfowl hunting? Why waterfowl hunting? And I have no idea why that did that. Apologize. Always going to have technology issues. So anyway, why waterfowl hunting? Well, the number one reason that I love waterfowl hunting is the most versatile type of hunting. Waterfowl hunting is done in all 49 states except for Hawaii and every Canadian province. I don't think there's a single type of hunting that you can say that's available in every state except for Hawaii and every province in Canada. Variety. And as we said earlier, when you're deer hunting. There's only one species of deer you're going to be targeting. White-tailed deer or mule deer or black-tailed deer. When you're elk hunting, it's just elk. With ducks, there's dabblers, there's divers, there's mallards, there's pintails, there's widgeon. There's such a huge variety in waterfowl hunting. And I haven't even touched on geese, you know, Canada geese, speckled belly geese, blue geese. There's such a variety that it can make for really interesting and fun mornings. You are control what happens. The more skill or the more time effort you put into it, the more likely you are to have a better hunt. You control the decoys, the calling. They all react to you. This is, you know, similar to kind of turkey hunting, but you have so much control over it. You can make it what you want it to be. The lifestyle of scouting, researching, dogs, game care. This is kind of universal to all hunting, but waterfowl hunting has got one of the most dedicated and loyal bases out there. Again and again and again, limit on ducks is 6, deer it's 1. You could shoot 1 deer and your hunt's over. Ducks, you can shoot up to 6 plus 5 geese at any given time, 15 coots, 15 mergansers. So you can do this repeatedly over and over and over again. It's not one shot and your day is over. Duck dogs. I love dogs. You guys can't see, but off screen, I've got my hunting dog sitting right beside me right now. Once you hunt behind a dog and get to see what it's been trained and bred and loves doing, it can change your opinion on hunting. Landscape. Ducks are found in every state in the United States, in every Canadian province. I personally have hunted ducks everywhere from the Atchafalaya Marsh in Louisiana to the North Dakota prairies to the Bering Sea in Alaska. There's not many species where you can follow them from as far north to as far south as you can go. Every hunt is different. Social, a lot of species, big game, turkeys. It's a very solitary, you need to be quiet, can't move around, can't talk much. That's not so with waterfowl. You can have conversations. You can laugh in the blind. You can go over things. It's a really big social event. You can waterfowl hunt in groups of up to 12 people at any given time. So it's supposed to be fun and a way for everybody to get together. Traditions and tech. Waterfowl hunting is filled with tradition, but it's also open to new technology where you can bring in new decoys, new blind technology, new shotguns, but it also can go all the way back to the old days of all you need is a shotgun. So waterfowl hunting is a great mix between tradition and technology. Finally, it's not covered on here, but conservation. The federal duck stamp, which we're going to cover later, is one of the greatest conservation tools the United States has ever come up with. Duck hunting puts so much money back into wetland protection, migratory bird work. It's a huge source of funding and conservation in the future. So the first thing we're going to kind of talk about is finding places to hunt. This is the biggest barrier for people when I ask them about getting into waterfowl hunting. I don't know where to do it. I don't know how to get into it. So the first thing you want to do is figure out what ducks and geese need. Ducks and geese need water and they need food. Those are the two main things that waterfowl need. So to get started, what a lot of people do is use different online sources. Onyx is a great one. If you guys aren't familiar, it's an online app that you can use to figure out things like public land. You can figure out where different water sources are, stuff like that. There's a couple different kinds of hunting land. The first is public hunting areas. So this is going to be things like your wildlife management areas. Certain refuges are open to hunting. Tribal land, state trust land, things like that. Great resources for that are things like HuntStand or OnX, where it's an app on your phone where you can go through and you can figure out and mark all these different hunting areas. The great thing about these areas is that most of them have things like food sources, water, availability. So generally there's a lot of birds on there. You can also do a lot of private land hunting. So in North Carolina, it might be a little bit different, but in North Dakota, where I'm from, most of the croplands are considered private lands, so they're privately owned. Waterfowl do a lot of feeding in dry fields. So you can go, you can knock on farmers' doors, you can ask them for permission to hunt on their property. Generally, it's pretty open. People are pretty open about letting you get on and get access to hunting. It just needs to put the time and the effort in to make that contact and get to work in about hunting. So if all that doesn't sound great to you, another option is just hire a guide. There's multiple different outfitters, multiple guides available in North Carolina. Give them a call, say, hey, I'm interested in getting into hunting. They'll have the gear for you. They've done the scouting. They'll be able to put you on birds if this is something you'd like to try. This could be a great option for first-time hunters, as it'll give you an easy opportunity to figure out if this is something you want to get into. You know, ask a lot of questions to these people. They're generally very knowledgeable, and they're kind of able to point you in the right general direction. So from there, we get into when to hunt waterfowl. So in North America, their waterfowl hunting is broken into what's called seasons. So these are set by the federal, provincial, and state agencies. So every state has got its own unique waterfowl seasons. So in your state and province, specifically the North Carolina one, I'm gonna pull over and just kind of show you guys an example. Deet was talking earlier about North Carolina's wildlife resources. I don't know, can you guys see this? Anybody?
Yep.
So in North Carolina, the duck season opens October 19th through October 21st. It's split, then it opens again on November 4th through November 25th. Then it's split again to where it opens on December 19th and closes on January 31st. That's in the inland zone. There's also the coastal zone. It's open October 27th, 28th. Then it opens November 4th through the 25th. And then it opens December 18th through the 31st. So these splits and zones are designed because they're things called flyways. So ducks fly down different paths. So ducks migrate every year. They go from northern latitudes to southern latitudes, following food sources south, and then they follow the snowbank north as food becomes available. So this is broken into areas where you're going to have more birds at a given time based on historical weather patterns, migration rates, stuff like that. They also have separate seasons for geese. So in North Carolina, there's a special early goose season, opens on September 1st, runs through September 30th. There's also the regular Canada goose season, which again has three separate splits in it from October 19th through the 28th, November 4th through the 25th, and December 18th through February 10th. Canada geese have some of the longest, most liberal seasons of any species. And there's also a spring season specifically for snow geese, which runs from February 12th through March 31st. So at any given time, there's about 6 to 7 months where some sort of waterfowl season is open in North Carolina. There's also several special seasons. I talked about a couple of them. One special one being the early teal season. So in North Carolina, there is a special season for strictly teal that's open from September 13th through September 30th. There's a special season for teal because teal tend to migrate extremely early following weather patterns. They're one of the earliest migrating ducks. So this is just kind of an opportunity for states like North Carolina to be able to harvest teal. There's also the special early Canada goose season. North Dakota has one as well. It opens on August 15th, runs through September 24th. So these are ways that, especially for the Canada goose season, it allows the states to bring in more harvest, as some of these populations, especially Canada geese, are extremely overpopulated. They're becoming a nuisance in like golf courses, local housing development, stuff like that. So this is just giving additional opportunities for hunters to help control some of these populations. There's also a lot of special youth days. So every state that I'm aware of offers a special opportunity where anybody under the age of 18 can be joined by an adult and get into hunting prior to seeing all the pressure of adults and all the other people getting into it. So these are really great ways to get kids involved. It's not covered on here, but most states also offer a special veterans hunt. So if your state offers this, you can, as a active or retired veteran, you get an additional weekend to hunt where you're not going to see everybody else out there as well. So one of the biggest things with waterfowl is regulations. So there is a list of regulations. You guys saw that based on just the season dates things that I was showing you and the zones. This is one of the biggest things people talk about when getting into waterfowl hunting is the regulations for waterfowl. Yes, they can get very complicated and complex, which is why it's very important that you studied some of this prior to hunting in your state. So the number one thing is licenses. So in order to hunt ducks and geese in North Carolina, you need to have your general state license, which you can also purchase via a sportsman's package. You need to have a federal duck stamp. We talked a little bit earlier about the federal duck stamp, but the federal duck stamp is, in my opinion, the single greatest conservation tool available in North America. The federal duck stamp costs $25. You're required to buy it to hunt any migratory bird. 24 of the 25 of those dollars go straight back into wetland habitat restoration and conservation. So this has put over $2 billion in conservation money back into wetlands since the start of 2000. So this is one of the greatest tools ever created. I highly encourage anybody, even if you're not waterfowl hunters, to purchase a federal duck stamp. Then you're also required to register for a HIP number, a Harvest Information Program registration. This is a series of 7 questions you'll be asked. Did you hunt ducks last year in North Carolina? If so, how many did you harvest? Did you hunt geese in North Carolina? If so, how many did you harvest? Did you hunt snipe, coots, or gallinules in North Carolina? If so, how many did you harvest? And did you hunt mourning doves in North Carolina in 2017? This is how we track harvest rates, along with several other different ways. This allows us to accurately set season dates and season lengths. And then in some states, not North Carolina, you're also required to buy a state duck stamp. North Carolina does not require this, but this is just additional funding that goes into state habitat conservation work. Bag limits. This is an extremely important thing for waterfowl. This is what I see most people getting confused about as far as regulations in duck hunting goes. So in North Carolina, you can harvest no more than 6 ducks a day. Of those 4 ducks, no more than 4 can be mallards. Of those, no more can be 2 can be hens. 3 wood ducks, 2 redheads, 2 canvasbacks, 2 black ducks, 1 pintail, and then 1 mottled or fulvous duck. You can harvest combinations of all these. There's mergansers where you can shoot 5 mergansers, no more than 2 of which can be hooded mergansers. So this is why it's very important for you to be able to understand the bag limits and regulations in your own state. This is all available at a click of a button on North Carolina's webpage. You also need to be aware of possession limits. So as you're harvesting birds, there's something called the possession limit. So the daily limit of ducks in North Carolina is 6. The possession limit is 3 times the daily limit. That means that you're allowed to have no more than 18 wild or waterfowl in your freezer at any given time. So if you go hunting 3 days in a row, you harvest 6 ducks 3 days in a row, you must eat or process 6 of those birds, or at least 1, before you're allowed to hunt the next day. This is another kind of confusing one that people get asked questions about all the time. Now we get into duck identification. So this is what I think limits most people from getting into waterfowl hunting is duck identification. Waterfowl identification can be very difficult. It requires a lot of practice and a lot of work to ensure that you know what you are harvesting. There's a variety of different tools out there available. One of the ones I like the most is this waterfowl identification guide that we created. It goes in depth on all different species located in the United States and Canada, goes through different ways of identifying them via, you know, wing beats, color patterns, stuff like that. And it goes really in depth on hens. So I think this is one of the best tools that you guys can find for that. There's a variety of them out there. Just hunting through the North Carolina website, North Carolina offers one of these as well. But the biggest thing is you just need to get out and you need to practice. You need to look at different birds in the air to kind of figure out what is what. You know, certain things like divers and dabblers, divers, which I'll cover a little bit later. So I guess I'll get into that. But dabblers are birds like mallards, pintails, blue wings, widgeons, stuff like that, that feed. And when they feed, they tip up. So their butt sticking in the air. That's where they got the name dabbler foam, as compared to divers, which are canvasbacks, redhead, scop, ringneck, ruddy duck. They dive for their food, hence the name divers. So just being able to distinguish between those two is huge. But there's a variety of different birds and ways of going through them. Again, I kind of talked to you guys about dabblers and divers. You can learn the different standout characters. So things like mallards. Drake mallards have a very dark green head that kind of stands off more. You know, wood ducks, they have a very squared off tail when they fly. Canvasbacks have a very sloped head. You can look at things like the spoonie, where it's got a very spoon-shaped bill. This is actually called the northern shoveler. Most people call it a spoonie, hence the nickname. Different sounds. You know, drake pintails make a really distinct whistling sound. Mallard hens quack. Gadwalls tend to make a very short, distinct quack. Wood duck hens make a very distinct squealing sound. There's a variety of different resources you can use to kind of look up some of these sounds. The Ornithology Lab of Cornell has a really great website on different waterfowl sounds. Delta Waterfowl and Ducks Unlimited both have different samples on their websites as well. It involves just a lot of studying and practicing. You can kind of learn the sizes of ducks. Things like teal and buffleheads are extremely small compared to ones like mallards and black ducks. Once you see a mallard flying with a teal, you'll be able to automatically distinguish that one's the teal, that one's the mallard. And then you can also kind of consider the regions that you guys are hunting. So in North Carolina where you're hunting, you're not going to see something like a cinnamon teal. Cinnamon teal are western coast ducks. So you can pretty much write off most of that. If you're hunting inland in North Carolina, meaning you're not on the coast, you won't have to worry about things like sea ducks, you know, harlequins, eiders, scoters, stuff like that. It's going to be your dabblers and your divers. So just kind of knowing where you're at will help you rule out certain species as well. But again, a lot of it just comes down to practicing, different sources of resources. Just getting out there and looking at birds in the sky will help you so much. Some other important rules that you guys need to follow or kind of should know. In most places, legal shooting hours for waterfowl is a half an hour before sunrise to sunset. Species like deer, it's usually a half an hour before sunrise to a half an hour after sunset. Waterfowl, it's very important to note that it's a half an hour before sunrise to sunset. Waterfowl for transportation. If you are to hunt waterfowl in a location and need to transport them unclean back to your house or clean back, it's important to note that you need to leave a fully feathered wing or a head attached to the carcass. This is for officer identification if you were to get pulled over. And this is very important, especially if you're going to start traveling between states to hunt, that you do this, or else you could be in violation of the Lacey Act. It's also very important to note that party hunting is not legal. Party hunting means that if I go out hunting with my dad and he shoots 8 ducks and I shoot 4, that's illegal. You're only allowed to harvest your own 6 birds. And then in certain areas, I don't think North Carolina is one of them. There's things like shell limits where you can only bring so many shells onto WMAs to hunt. But it is important to note that for waterfowl hunting, you are only allowed to have 3 shells in your shotgun at every given time. It must be plugged so that no more than 2 shells can be loaded into the magazine at any given time. So from there, we're gonna get into scouting. So I'm gonna play this short video. Just know that scouting is one of the most important aspects of waterfowl hunting.
If it came down to picking one factor that can dramatically improve your waterfowl hunting success, it would have to be scouting. Finding the birds, knowing their habits, and developing a good plan to hunt them based on what you see will far outweigh a lack of equipment or hunting skills like calling, decoying, and more. Before the hunting season, you can scout terrain and conditions. You will learn which wetlands are holding water, what crops are planted where, and how to gain access to what hopefully will be prime hunting locations. Once the hunting season arrives, you scout where ducks and geese are roosting, where they're feeding, when they move, and what flight paths they favor. When you put it all together, you can figure out where the birds want to be on any given day and be there waiting for them. That accomplishment is one of duck and goose hunting's great rewards. The other big benefit of scouting is watching the birds. You'll learn so much about what attracts and what scares off ducks and geese. You'll learn how they interact with each other in flocks and in family groups. And you'll learn how flocks interact with other flocks and how they respond to changing conditions. You'll also learn how to tell one species from another in flight. These are all highly valuable lessons that will boost both your hunting success and enjoyment.
So kind of touched on a few things, but there's two major parts or types of scouting. There's preseason scouting and there's in-season scouting. So in preseason, or I guess start off talking about things for scouting. First off, binoculars. Having a good pair of binoculars are extremely important. Being able to know how to use them, make sure they're set up correctly for your eyes. If you have glasses, if your setup's correctly, just extremely important. Maps, GPSs, apps like Onyx, all of this is extremely important for your scouting kits. So the first type of scouting is preseason scouting. So this is kind of where you can look at things like wetland maps. Is it dry this year? Does this wetland even have water in it? Is it worth looking at later in the season? Satellite maps that are available online are extremely helpful for this. You can also look at things like plat maps where it has landowners information on it. So you can start looking and building contact lists and things like that. The second type is in-season scouting. Now, this is the most important one. Get out there, check out places you plan to hunt. Go out there the evening before you want to hunt. Know where the ducks are sitting, what direction they're coming in from, what kind of birds are in there. If you see them feeding in certain areas, follow them back to where they're what's called roosting, which is where ducks will spend the night at, or vice versa. Follow them from the roost to their feed. It's just important to get out there, see where they're at, see where they're moving to, see what they're feeding in. This is probably, if you're interested in getting into waterfowl hunting, the most important thing that will lead to success in waterfowl hunting. So then you get into how to hunt ducks. There's four different ways of hunting ducks. The first is on water with decoys. The second is decoys in the field. Third is pass shooting. And the fourth is by jump shooting. So when we're talking about on the water, this is probably the most common way you'd hunt ducks in North Carolina. Basically, waterfowl spend a majority of time in the water. Figure out where they want to be at in the water. You can either boat out to it, you can walk out to it. You'll end up generally hiding in things like standing cattails. You'll put out a decoy spread, call them into you. You're basically hunting over water. Boats, canoes, stuff like that are very important. In the field, this isn't going to be nearly as common in North Carolina as it is in other states, like where I'm located in North Carolina. But species like Canada geese, mallards, pintails do a lot of feeding in dry crop fields, harvested wheat fields, harvested corn fields. So figure out where they're at, where you're going to hide. Can you put a layout blind in the field? Is there a rock pile where you can put your blind at? Stuff like that is extremely important for hunting in places like the field. Jump shooting. This is a pretty common way people start off getting into waterfowl hunting. People see where ducks are landing at in the water or in a field. They find a way that they can sneak out there, and basically they sneak up on the birds and jump them in order to harvest them. This can be a really exciting way of waterfowl hunting. It puts a lot of spare chase and sneak into it. And it can be a really selective way and helpful way for people to learn their waterfowl identification. They can spend time studying a wetland, seeing the birds that are on it, and then they can sneak out to it and harvest just that one bird. So this tends to be a really popular way for new waterfowl hunters to get into waterfowl hunting. And then the last way is pass shooting. So this is basically figuring out the birds are here and they want to be in another location. I'm going to figure out a way where I can get between them and that other location, and then I can harvest them as they are flying overhead. This is probably the least common way that people waterfowl hunt, but it's becoming more and more popular, and it can be extremely useful for days where it's like extremely windy out and birds are flying very, very low. So after talking about that, let's talk a little bit about some of the gear that you're going to need to get into waterfowl hunting. Now, we're going to talk about a few things moving forward, but I want everybody to remember that waterfowl hunting can seem like a very expensive, hard to get into sport. All you really need to hunt waterfowl is a shotgun and a license. Everything else can work out. So I'm going to talk about some gear that can be helpful, and some of it you may need, but it's very important to note that you do not require all of this gear moving forward. The first and foremost is a shotgun. You will need a shotgun in order to hunt. That's kind of standard. Unless you're going to take a falcon out or a bow in some cases, a shotgun is required. 20 gauge, 12 gauges, both of them are standard loads. A lot of people prefer 12 gauges. I know a lot of people who hunt strictly with 20 gauges. Secondly, is you're going to need shells. It's important to note that for all migratory bird hunting, you are required to have non-toxic shot. Steel, bismuth, copper, you cannot use lead to hunt migratory birds in the United States. Ammunition, again, I talked about that a little bit. Steel, no, all non-toxic. And then decoys. So when you see a lot of people waterfowl hunting, you'll see massive decoy spreads. Floating decoys, silhouettes, full body field decoys. These can be extremely helpful, but they're not always necessary. Sometimes a few decoys work better than a lot of decoys. It can just depend upon how many birds are in the field. You can find decoys on a lot of different locations, your local sporting goods store, Craigslist, eBay, garage sales, anything like that. You'll be able to pick up several decoys for very cheap prices. Calls. Calls are not always essential, especially if you're pass shooting or jump shooting waterfowl, but a lot of people really like to blow duck calls. We're going to talk about duck calling a little bit later on in this presentation as far as like the getting down into the weeds of it. But similar to this, you can purchase them online, your local sporting goods store, local, we give them away at local ducks on our Delta Waterfowl banquets. There's a lot of different ways. Most calls cost under $10, so they can be pretty cheap to pick up. Clothing and waders. Now, this is where people tend to go extreme on clothing and waders. Waders are generally necessary to hunt waterfowl, as a majority of waterfowl are harvested over water. Waders come in a variety of different ways. Neoprene waders, lightweight waders, stocking foot waders. Just kind of depends upon your personal preference. I own a couple different pairs of neoprene waders, one for very late season hunting and then a very light one for early season hunting. Sometimes you can get by with hip boots that only cover you up to your hips. If you're hunting in water, that's not very deep. And then clothing. The most important thing is some sort of a camouflage outer layer. It can be a lighter shell that you can wear over top of a hooded sweatshirt or lighter stuff, but it's very important that some sort of outer camouflage layer. Blinds and boats. So in North Carolina, you may find some areas that you need a boat or a kayak to access the hunt. It's very important in this case that the boat or the kayak is not a brightly colored like orange or yellow kayak, as this can be an extreme turnoff for waterfowl. So some sort of dull colored kayak or boat is essential. Blinds, multiple different blinds, some of them attached directly to your kayak. Some of them you can set up in the shoreline or the weeds when you get to where you want to hunt. Again, available variety of different places, online, local sporting goods store, can run anywhere from $50 to upwards of thousands of dollars, depending upon how in depth you want to go. Some other sort of gear that you might find you want a blind bag, some sort of a carry-all to put your GPS, your drinks, your lunch, headlamps, face masks, just additional gear. You know, headlamps are very important. A lot of waterfowl hunting starts early or ends late, so you might find you want additional light. Ears and eye protection, it's always really important to have some sort of an eye protection or ear protection. Don't be like me, I shoot too much without hearing protection and I already can't hear very well out of my right ear. And then phone apps, again, we talked about some of them, OnX, different apps that help you identify weather patterns or duck identification apps. And you also want to take photos to show your family and friends. A lot of people like to come up with a checklist. I don't like this list because I think it's way too long, but things like shotgun, ammunition, blind bags, shooting glasses, phone, headlamp, GPS, knife. I've seen a lot of different blind bags that have a lot of different gear in it. Some people have the bare minimum. Some people have even more than listed on this one. But it's like I said, it's really important to note at the end of the day, you need a shotgun and you need a license. That's all you need to duck hunt. All of this stuff can be considered extra. So calling waterfowl. This is what a lot of people question about. Oh, I don't know if I can do this. You know, how do you do about doing this? Calling for waterfowl is kind of a really fun process. I'm going to start off by showing you guys this short clip.
As a new hunter, you don't have to know how to call ducks and geese in order to be successful hunting them. However, learning to call ducks and geese can give you a direct connection to the birds you are hunting. This direct connection can be one of hunting's great rewards. Like any skill, learning to call takes practice, but you'll find the time invested well worth it the first time you make a duck or goose spin on a dime, dump into the decoys. Delta's Duck and Goose Hunting 101 course provides you a starting point to learn how to blow the calls and how best to use the various sounds to attract birds. Once you've nailed the basics, then you can take duck and goose calling as far as you want, even to big time competition. But for now, let's start with the basics.
So learning to call can seem kind of intimidating to a lot of people. A lot of it comes down to just practicing. And what I found to be extremely helpful for me was that I went to a wetland and I just listened to the ducks. I listened to the different sounds that they made. And I thought to myself, how can I imitate some of those sounds? And then I started doing things like going to YouTube, listening to people like Jim Ronquest, Fred Zink, Will Primos. They're all available for free on YouTube. And they have a variety of extremely helpful short videos on how to call different sorts of ducks and geese. Some mallards are the most harvested waterfowl in the United States. So a lot of people like to start off with kind of basic mallard calls. I'm just going to show you guys this. Mallards are extremely popular in North Carolina. So you guys may find this useful.
I'll be using calls designed to mimic the sounds of a mallard hen. Mallards are the most common duck in North America and often respond really well to calling. Other species that are often found with mallards, like teal, gadwall, and pintail, will also respond to the sounds of the mallard. Let's start off with the basics of holding the call. This part of the call is called the barrel. You will be blowing air into the opening at the end. The other end holds the reeds and is called the insert. Grab the end of the insert between your thumb and forefinger just like this. You'll use the rest of your hand to adjust as necessary to change the sound of the call. Put your bottom lip underneath the opening at the end of the call and place your top lip against the opening like this. Remember, blowing a duck call is like playing an instrument, and you'll need to adjust your tongue and mouth to control airflow and create the best sound. To blow the call, you need to bring up air from your chest. We use the same source of air to vibrate our vocal cords when we talk. And you need to do the same thing to properly blow a duck call. Think of how you would fog up a mirror. Not like you're trying to blow out candles. We're not going to cover every type of call in this video, but we'll cover some of the basics. The most important call to master is the quack, because many of the advanced calls are just a series of quacks at different speeds and pitches. Even if all you can do is quack at circling ducks, you may be able to keep them interested and lure them into gun range. Using the air from your chest, say, or quack, Allow me to demonstrate and feel free to call along with me as we go. You'll often hear hens making contented quacks while they're sitting on the water or feeding. Once you feel comfortable with your quack, you can move on to the greeting call. The greeting call is essentially five quacks, with each quack a little shorter and quieter than the last. Here's what it sounds like. You can see how I'm opening and closing my hand for each quack. You can count the quacks in your head to help you with the rhythm. One, two, three, four, five. The greeting call is really useful when you first spot ducks at a distance and want to make sure they see your decoys. The next call I'll demonstrate is often called the comeback call. It's similar to the greeting call, but with a faster cadence and more pleading sound. Ducks usually have 5 to 7 rapid quacks in their comebacks. If ducks ignore your greeting call and are leaving your area, many hunters will try a comeback call. Like anything, the key to becoming a better caller is practice. You've got to find the right amount and type of air to make ducky sounds. Once you do, you need practice to teach your muscles how to make those sounds repeatedly. One of the best ways to get better at duck calling is to visit a refuge or park in your area that has some wild ducks, especially in the fall and winter when they're most vocal. Listen to the different sounds they make and when they make them and try to mimic them. You'll quickly notice that not all hens sound the same. Some may sound more raspy or use a different cadence. They will also make some crazy sounds, so don't worry if your calls aren't perfect. My final thought about duck calling is about when and how much to call. As you spend more time hunting, you'll learn to read the reactions of ducks to your calling. Depending on the day, ducks may want to hear a lot of calling or none at all. If the ducks have their wings cupped and headed towards my decoys, I usually call very little and watch them closely. If they start to turn away, I may give them a pleading greeting call to try to keep them headed to my decoys. Hopefully, they'll end up in gun range. Good luck.
That was just kind of a brief outline of waterfowl calling, especially for ducks. There's a multitude of different resources, websites, YouTube videos that can walk you through waterfowl calling. Again, there's 100 different ways and 100 different types of calls, but it's all going to be what you practice and what you feel comfortable with, and especially in your local area, what the ducks are going to respond to. Given the fact that we're running a little bit low on time, I'm going to walk through and skip some of these videos, but goose calling is similar to waterfowl calling. It's a different type of call. When you go to purchase your calls, they'll be very specific in this is a goose call, this is a duck call. Canada geese calls, snow goose calls, speckled belly calls. Just make sure the one you purchase says goose on it. And again, it comes down to practice and figuring out what's going to work for the birds in your area. There's other different types of duck calls. We focused mainly on mallards and geese, but things like green-winged teal, mallards, pintails, widgeon, all of them have very kind of distinct calls. Again, different resources you can listen to and learn what they make, but it all again comes down to just practice and what's in your local area. Just kind of some other calling tips. You can seek out your local calling club. The North Carolina Callers is the one that comes off the top of my head. They're always happy to involve new participants, go through classes, take you guys out on different organization workshops, stuff like that. They can be a great resource for you. And then calling is fickle. What works one day might not work the next day. Don't be afraid to try something new. If it's not working, don't keep doing it. Go to something else. It just depends upon each and every single day. So decoying waterfowl. Once you've gone out, you've done your scouting, you figured out where you want to go, then you can look at things like wind direction, the sun, the weather. This is all going to help you figure out where to put your decoys out at. Kind of some of the basics, wind direction. Ducks always want to land into the wind. They always want to be coming face first into it. It helps them slow down, spreads their feathers out, and helps them land easier. So it's really important to note that when you're setting up, you ideally always want the wind at your back. Path of the Sun. This doesn't always end up working out with well with the wind, but waterfowl hunting is generally an early morning activity. You do not want to be looking directly into the sun in the morning if you can help it. That hurts with waterfowl ID. It also makes you stand out a little bit more. This doesn't always work out, especially with the wind, but ideally if you can set it up to where you are not looking directly into the rising sun, this is going to work better for you. And then setting decoys in relation to your hiding spot. You don't want the decoys more than 20 to 25 yards out away from you, as that generally tends to land, they tend to land short of it, and it'll make for too far of a shot for you. And there's nothing more frustrating than sitting in the blind in the morning, watching ducks and geese land 50 to 80 yards out from you and watching them do that all day as you're not able to shoot into them. The visibility of your decoys. You want your decoys placed in areas where ducks and geese can see them. You don't want them sitting right on the cattail edge if you're in the water, or standing in extremely tall vegetation or crops if you're hunting in a field. You want them out in the open where birds can see them. Movement. Things like mojo decoys. So mojo decoys are decoys that are battery powered that have a spinning wing. This kind of stuff is extremely helpful. It catches the duck's eyes. It makes them want to come land in your area. There's another setup called the jerk rig. Basically, you attach a string to one of your decoys in the water and you run it all the way back to where you're standing. And then you can just sit there and pull on it, and it'll make the duck move back and forth, kind of more like an actual live waterfowl. Things like this can be extremely helpful. And it all just kind of depends upon the day and the ducks you're hunting. Flags. If you're hunting geese, a flag, which is basically a simple, you know, plastic outline of a goose that you wave back and forth, can help attract the attention of a goose and get them to turn and look in your direction. Stuff like that can be very helpful. Just kind of some other tips for you. Don't put your decoys very close together. Most ducks don't want to be touching in the field. So if they're touching, it might look fake to the ducks, but you also want them kind of randomly spread. You don't want them, you know, obviously set up a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in a line. They need to look more random. It's also important to note that if you're hunting a group of ducks that's kind of smaller, say there was only 100 ducks in there the night before, you don't need very large decoy spreads. You can put out 5 to 10 decoys, that'll be plenty. Whereas when you're hunting snow geese in flocks of, you know, 15 to 20,000, you might feel the need to put out more than, you know, 150, 300 decoys, stuff like that. It all depends specifically upon the area you're hunting, the number of birds, and how you're feeling or what the birds are feeling like that day. I'm going to skip some of this. Like I said, I'm going to jump around a little bit just because we're kind of running out of time here. And there's a few other kind of critical things I want to talk about. Duck dogs. So everybody's kind of got their own rules when it comes to hunting over dogs. My specific rule is if my dog is in the decoys, you're not going to be shooting. We don't want any accidents. It's important to note that dogs can make hunting much more fun. I love hunting with my dog. I don't really enjoy hunting without my dog. He loves it more than I do, and he gets mad at me when I leave him. But safety is the number one priority. You don't want to put your dog in a compromising situation. Retrieving birds without a dog can be difficult. That's why it can occasionally be handy to have something like a kayak with, especially if you're hunting in deeper water, or just be prepared to walk out and get it. When you're hunting with somebody else's dog, it's important to ask them, hey, do you have any specific rules when it comes to your dog? Do you not want me shooting when the dog's in the decoys? Do you not want me saying anything when you're trying to get your dog on the bird? Stuff like that. It all comes down to etiquette, and you won't know unless you ask. There's no such thing as a stupid question. And most people love talking about their dogs. After the hunt. So this is extremely important for people. When you're a responsible hunter, your order of after the hunt should go: take care of your dogs, take care of the birds, take care of your gear, and then take care of yourself. Dogs should always come first because their health and happiness kind of drives their future performance, and you want them to be there. You want to make sure that the bad game comes next because you don't want it to spoil. You want it to show, you know, proper respect for it. You want to make sure your gear is all put away correctly so it doesn't rust or rot. and then you want to take care of yourself last. You know, cleaning equipment for waterfowl, you're going to need either a very sharp knife, sometimes having a pair of shears is there, fresh water, Ziploc bags to put them in, and a solid table to work on. I wanted to get to this video, which I might have jumped past, because our chief scientist, Frank Rohr, does a very good job in walking through cleaning waterfowl for this. And this is a really important thing for most people.
Hi, I'm Joel Bryce, Vice President of Waterfowl and Hunter Recruitment Programs for Delta Waterfowl. As you know, it's a tremendous thrill to watch mallards, teal, and pintail twist and turn over the decoys, then successfully harvest one or two. But the real reward comes later on, the dinner table. Here are some tips shown to you by Frank Rohr on preparing birds for the table.
An easy and common way to clean birds is to simply fillet their breast meat, often referred to as breasting them out. All you have to do is expose the breast meat and then carefully work your knife around the breastbone to remove both breasts. For mallards and most puddle ducks, the skin will pull back with little effort. Some divers, like ringnecks and golden eyes and buffleheads, may require you to slice the skin from the breast as you go. Another way to breast the duck out is to start by plucking all the breast feathers, which pull out pretty easily. And then you fillet the meat, leaving it attached to the skin. I call this staking a duck, since it leaves you with grilling meat that rivals, in my opinion, a good ribeye. You're left with two skin-on breasts, and once you taste the crispy duck skin, you'll agree that this little extra effort is well worth the added cleaning time. Don't forget the leg and thigh meat, which makes great soup or pulled duck sandwiches when slowly simmered in a crock pot. There are, however, a couple of drawbacks to just taking the breast and legs out of ducks. It gets most of the meat, but not all of it, and you miss out on the rich flavors of all that golden brown duck skin. For many hunters, the ultimate way to clean ducks for the table is to pluck them and dress the entire bird. If you're going to store meat for a while, I strongly suggest storage that keeps the meat sealed from the air and from freezer burn. The simple approach is to use quarter pint freezer bags. I add a little water and I get as much air out of the bag as possible. Mallard fillets will store for well over 6 months or more. Vacuum sealers are even better at keeping the meat in good condition. I have had excellent duck after even more than a year frozen in a vacuum sealed bag. Make sure to label what you put in the freezer so you can keep your freezer organized.
So that was just kind of a quick introduction to cleaning. We talked a little bit about some of the gear. If you're interested in getting more into it, we have multiple YouTube videos on specific ways of different cleaning methods for birds. Again, the most common one is breasting. Basically you will expose the breast meat. There's the breast bone, which runs right along the middle of the breast. You can run your knife right along that and peel the breast straight off of it. Waterfowl meat is some of the best meat in the world to me. I love eating waterfowl meat, so I always generally pluck them and leave the skin on, and I take the legs as well. A lot of people might not agree with me, but like I said, I think duck is the best eating meat that there is. I can feel Deet shaking his head in the background as he talks about turkeys and deer, but it's also very important that if you're going to leave them stored, label them with the date that you clean them, the species they are, the location that you hunted or harvest them, and your name. This will help you keep legal if for some reason you were ever to be checked by a game warden. We didn't talk a lot about wanton waste, but wanton waste basically means that it is illegal for you to harvest a bird and then not harvest the meat. So you kill it and then you just throw it away. That is very highly illegal. We have to throw a caveat on here that Alaska's wanton waste laws are different. This doesn't claim to you guys, but in Alaska, it means that in order to not be in violation of their wanton waste laws, you need to harvest the back, the leg, the thigh meat from the birds. Montana has also recently adopted this. I highly encourage this to everybody. Duck legs are one of the best delicacies and best well-kept secrets of waterfowl. So just something to think about moving forward. Cooking your ducks. Very briefly, Again, like I said, I think waterfowl is delicious. There's a hundred different ways of preparing it. Most commonly is duck poppers. Cut the breast into small pieces, put a jalapeno pepper and cream cheese, wrap it in bacon, marinate it in some sort of marinade. A very common one is Italian salad dressing, and then grill it on the grill very fast and very high heat until the bacon is done. These are absolutely delicious. You can do steaks. Again, like Frank said, basically marinate it, throw something like Montreal steak seasoning on it, and then grill it very fast at very high heat. The most important thing for eating waterfowl is you do not want to overcook it. If you overcook it, anything past medium rare, it is going to get very tough, it is going to get very leathery, and it can taste like overcooked liver. So most people, when they tell me that I don't like eating ducks and geese, to every time I tell them that, I tell them they haven't had it properly done. On that note, if you do not like meat cooked past medium rare, waterfowl might not be for you. Dude, I'm sitting right at 7 o'clock here. So I kind of covered most important things about waterfowl hunting. Do you want to open it up to questions here?
Absolutely. And I just have to say, to start with, when Jacob and I first discussed this, this is the first, like, say, very informational website that we did. And I initially had some reservations, and I'm discovering that they were unfounded. Not only would it was very informative, and it's also a resource for you folks to go in depth to, but it was extremely well narrated. And it's pretty neat too that a guy from North Dakota already also looked up into North Carolina regulations. So that means to me that, folks, we have no excuse in our home state. I guess a couple of questions for you, Jacob, is first, I will be sharing the recording, so obviously they have your narration, very well done. Is there a login required? And obviously you'll be sending me the link that I can share with them in the post-webinar survey when they have the recording. So yeah, I guess you'll have a link. And do they need to log in? Will they need anything for that?
They will need to register for the course. So we partnered with Calcami for this course. So basically, Calcami and I, we have created this Waterfowl Hunting 101 course. There's also a similar created course for deer hunting that we did with QDMA. And then there is a course that Pheasants Forever put together that covers basically upland hunting. And then there is a course for squirrel hunting. So if you're interested in this course, I'll send Deet the link. There, just note that there's additional courses available as well.
Very, very well done. And yeah, I don't even need to go back to that Q&A slide. We can start here. And again, what we will do is, as I usually do, I narrate, and then we'll, yeah, we have time for questions. And obviously folks did wait to the end. And again, Jacob, very, very well done, man. And yes, I will say that I love my turkey and my deer, but that stuff was looking pretty good. So I don't know, but you know, yeah, I spend enough money as it is. So anyway, to get started, during the video for storing ducks in the freezer, did he recommend adding water to the bag, it looks like, before freezing? If so, why?
So yes, he did recommend adding water to the bag. Now, that is only if you are not vacuum sealing your birds. If you are going to vacuum seal them, do not add water. Basically, you add water because it helps you get a better seal on the bag, and it's easier to get all of the air out of the bag when you're trying to freeze them. So if you're going to vacuum seal them, do not worry about putting water in it. But if you're going to be just putting them in a Ziploc bag, fill it to just to the top of the meat with water. And then as you're zipping the bag, push down so that water is consistently coming out as you seal it. That'll help you get all of the air out of the bag so it stores longer and stays better longer.
Awesome. I've hunted on the Potomac River in Maryland, and hunting spots on the water are tightly controlled. How does NC control hunting on large bodies of water like Pamlico or the Neuse River? First come, first serve, or do you need a permit? What advice do you have dealing with other hunters on public land? I've read horror stories about hunting on popular spots like Catfish Lake, fights, vehicle damage, sabotaging the hunt, etc. I'd like to hunt some of the permitted areas, but rather not have to deal with any nonsense from other hunters. Well, being from North Carolina, I can just add this. I'm a public land hunter. Yes, I would say overall that the resources for waterfowl hunting, although abundant, are a little bit more limited than walking in the woods anywhere else. Yes, we do have those permit hunts. I do suggest you take advantage of those permit hunts. And from what I've seen, even in being a technician on Goose Creek when I worked at the New Bern Wildlife Depot, is it was usually first come, first serve, except for when it is permit hunts and it is more control. So I think it's important what Jacob talked about is to get out there, to do your scouting, to find out spots that, I mean, obviously are accessible, easily accessible. And sometimes those back in places, I've heard people talk even with waterfowl, and I'm not a waterfowl hunter, that you can hunt the impoundments that a lot of them get crowded, but the woods nearby, especially woodies. I was standing one time deer hunting while I could hear the folks shooting on the waterfowl impoundment, and I had woodies flying over my head, and I'm standing there with a rifle hunting deer. Or those creek bottoms were often woodies that, you know, will go. And again, I'm a deer and turkey hunter primarily. So get out there, you know, not to be too long-winded, but get out there, do some scouting, take advantage of the permit hunt, be there first, you know, and you'll find some good hunting. Now, as far as those fights and vehicle damage, that's nonsense. It potentially happens, but just have respect for hunters and have respect, obviously, for yourself. We share the land and finally ending. When I'm deer hunting, I'm usually way back in away from other hunters. Sometimes you can accomplish that on water, but have a plan A, B, C, D, and E, just in case you run into problems. Would you add anything for that, Jacob, relative to where you are?
No, just what you said. You know, etiquette is huge for waterfowl hunting, and it's something that people tend to ignore. But, you know, my opinion on public land hunting is I get there very early. And if I am beat to that spot, I don't try to set up, you know, 50 yards away from somebody. I don't try to crowd them. I don't, you know, argue with them that this was my spot. I go to my next spot. I have a couple different ideas lined up where I want to go. The whole fight thing, the whole arguing about vehicle damage, sabotaging the hunt, those aren't hunters to me. They're not good people. They're not hunters. They're people that we don't want to be associated with. So I always try to take the high road, and I've had people do this to me. I've been set up on a wetland ready to go, and I've had people come in 20 minutes before hunting time, throw their decoys 30 yards from me and think they're going to hunt there. I always try to take the high road with it and try not to start anything, but you know, etiquette, honor it. If somebody else beat you to it, go to your next spot. Don't start any problems with it. Don't do things like taking high shots at flying over birds that might be going to somebody else's. Just little things like that. You know, it all comes down to treat somebody how you want to be treated.
Yeah, it's good. Very good point. Value your opinion from North Dakota, but NC couldn't be more different when it comes to public land, private land, number of waterfowl. I just saw what new hunters thinking they're going to head out the door and see even close to the number of ducks North Dakota has or be able to gain access to private land. There is a reality to NC duck hunting, and that is we don't have many ducks. And that may be absolutely the case. Again, Deke James is not a waterfowl hunter. And from what I understand, and you may be able to allude to this too, Jacob, since you've hunted a lot of places besides North Dakota, is I've heard that duck hunting is largely dependent on freeze up in northern states. I mean, if birds have access to water and them flyways, I've heard sometimes that can be far less come south. So is that kind of true too?
Yeah. So it's waterfowl migration is driven a lot by weather. Especially where I'm at, the Central Flyway, Louisiana, Texas, well, Louisiana is the Mississippi Flyway, but Texas, Oklahoma, they won't start seeing a lot of birds until it freezes in North Dakota. Waterfowl don't want to have to fly south. They don't. It burns up energy. It's hard on their bodies. It can be extremely dangerous for them. They want to go as least far south as they can. If it doesn't freeze in North Dakota and South Dakota, Kansas, Oklahoma, and Texas won't see as many birds. It's similar in the Atlantic Flyway where you guys are at. It needs to get colder in New York, in Maine, in Maryland to push those birds down into the flyway. Our reality is, and I'm not going to try to get into any kind of political arguments or anything with here, but the climate is generally warmer now. We're seeing some of that where climate change is leading to birds not migrating as far south. That being said, there is still very good waterfowl hunting to be had in North Carolina. A lot of it is just putting in the time to figure out where the birds are at, what WMA is, what public land, what private land are they in, where are they at? It all comes down to scouting. I talked to a couple of my friends in North Carolina. We have two regional directors in North Carolina. They do a lot of hunting in North Carolina, and there is still a lot of good hunting to be had. It's just putting in the time to figure out where they're at.
What changed in NC that moved our mallard limit from 2 mallards to 4? NC already has a very limited number of mallards inland, but the season always seems to be changing. What drives this? Well, I think some of that is the part of the weather, but since these, and again, you being a waterfowl person, Jacob, all of this is established by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, not North Carolina, correct?
Correct. The U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the federal, they pretty much limit and regulate harvest and species and limits and stuff like that. What's driving the mallard change, and this has been a huge topic in the Atlantic Flyway for the last couple of years. So Atlantic Flyway is running a couple of different reasons. Genetics with farm-raised mallards, pen-released mallards is kind of interbreeding with some of the certain mallards. Mallard populations were falling, now they're rising. Basically, these regulations are updated every year based upon band survey data, parts and species, or parts and pieces collection surveys, the BPOP survey, new genetic work done specifically up in New York that's showing some of these changes. This is always going to change just based upon the new science that comes out. Generally, you'll see a two-year delay. So the decisions made right now for the 2025 hunting season. So it just kind of comes down the road. These are going to change every year just based upon whatever new data we have.
Yep. Well, I'm seeing right now, we don't have any questions, so we'll give it about a minute or two. And if there are no more, we will be closing for tonight. Any additional anecdotes you have, Jacob? I know, again, me, I'm kind of the last guy out here when it comes to waterfowl hunting. But thankfully, now that you guys are doing these, and again, I greatly appreciate Jacob being here, because currently, he was my only connection to Delta for some time and the person willing to be involved in outreach. So we're very fortunate to have him tonight. But now we have a couple questions again. Okay.
Yeah. I'm looking at the liberal one.
Thank you for taking these. One more. Do you see waterfowl limits becoming more liberal or conservative moving forward? Yep.
Okay. So just a quick background on this for anybody else. Waterfowl seasons are split into three regulations. There's a liberal season, a moderate season, and a conservation season. We have been living since like 1993 in the liberal season. Max season dates, max harvest regulations. So in this case, 4 mallards. I think it comes out to be about a 60 some day season. 4 mallards, 3 wood ducks, 2 redheads. The conservative season would drop that down to something like a 30-day season and a 3 duck limit. This is driven based upon waterfowl population trends, habitat regulations, the breeding population surveys, band recording, stuff like that. To answer your question on this, I don't know. There's been a lot of talk recently about different season regulations and lengths based upon some of the BPOP survey stuff. BPOP is the breeding population survey. Every year, biologists in the United States and Canada will fly a predetermined track to count the number of breeding pairs of waterfowl that they see. They've been doing this survey since like 1964. It is actually currently the longest running wildlife survey in the world. A fact that my professor told me when I was doing my master's degree at LSU that kind of stuck with me was that we know currently more about our waterfowl populations in the United States than most third world countries know about their human populations. So waterfowl are one of the most studied species out there. So long-winded way of getting around to, I think that we're going to see liberal for the next couple of years. After that, it's going to depend a lot upon habitat, conservation work, the breeding surveys. I could see us, and I could see in the next 10 to 15 years, going to a conservative season, but for right now, I don't see it switching from liberal anytime soon.
Okay. And obviously a thank you guys. Great job. We appreciate that. We always try to make these very informative and of course address concerns of folks. Thanks guys. Very welcome. Okay. Now that we're down to the last, I just want to let you folks know again, I'll be getting the link from Jacob. I will inform the staff. I'm waiting right now for a waterfowl and a squirrel webinar to be processed, because what happens is they go up into the cloud in the Zoom portal, and then they have to be downloaded and processed into a YouTube, and I'll be getting them out. Okay, we do have a question here popped up regarding your earlier statement regarding hunter etiquette. Last year, I witnessed hunters on a boat attempting to push a flock of sea ducks on an NC river closer to other hunters on stationary boats with blinds. Is this considered hunter harassment for other hunters on the same body of water that were not associated with these hunters?
Hunter harassment, no, but it is highly illegal to use motorcraft, boats, cars, even just walking and scaring birds to other people hunting. So that's highly illegal. I don't think you could technically charge them with harassment, but it's never something that should be done. And like I said, it's highly illegal to do.
Yeah, it sounds almost like deer drives for ducks, right?
Yeah, essentially, except for deer drives are legal, are they not?
Yes, oh, absolutely, walking, yes. Yeah, and dog hunting is in certain areas of the state, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But no, stuff like that is highly illegal, and it gives actual hunters a bad name.
Yes, and unfortunately, as in any avocation, there's always going to be less desirables. And one of the first things I do when I see things, including like baiting on public land, which is illegal, is turning people in. And I don't go argue with somebody. I get license plates or I GPS the areas where the bait is, and then enforcement sits on it, because these people are basically stealing or harassing or cheating with public trust resources. So we're the eyes and ears out there, folks. I was thinking the same thing. Very informative. Thank you. You're very welcome. So again, yeah, I'll get that out as soon as possible. Any other comments, Jacob? And we'll wait a minute here to see if any other questions pop up.
So if anybody is interested still in hunting and wants to know more, the course is a great way to start, but also feel free. There's local Delta Waterfowl chapters all throughout North Carolina. It's all located on our website as far as chapter contact info. Feel free to reach out to any of those guys. I am a pretty avid duck hunter. As I said, I do as much as I can, but North Carolina is not my specialty. Those guys in North Carolina are always willing to help out. They're always willing to point people in the right direction, and they're local, so they'll be able to help you out more than I may be able to with some North Carolina specific questions.
And when it comes to that too, especially being social, folks, as many of you probably know, if you attended the other webinars, I'm one of those baby boomers. You know, I just turned 63, and I can remember my generation, you know, especially growing up in Pennsylvania, which had one of the largest number per capita of hunters, similar to, it's PA, Wisconsin, Texas, is you didn't share anything with anybody. And there were all kind of crazy things that went on. What I'm excited about today in this newer conservation-minded niche market that I'm working with is they are far more social. They're not going to give you GPS points, waypoints to an area, but they're far more social to share information and be social, and you know, even general areas where that was taboo. Somebody asked you when I was growing up in central PA, where'd you get that deer? They'd say in the woods. Where'd you get that fish? In the water. So I see this positive trend. And yes, it's not universal. It's not going to be everybody, but I think more people are willing to share. But that said, you putting in your effort and your due diligence, you know, we live in this technological world that continually kind of spoon feeds us. And hunting is a great equalizer. That's when you're going to have to put all your skills together, do your scouting, and the animal isn't like, you know, like I'll often say, in the department store, the Halloween stuff's not in the front 3 weeks earlier. or the Christmas stuff isn't the same either. It does separate, you know, those that are willing to take that extra effort. And even in, and it's easy for me to get long-winded, but I often will say in a class like a GSO or even a webinar, probably 50%, maybe 60% of those folks will really dig in. They will be responsible. They will be respectful, and they will be successful in many ways, including harvest. So, everything isn't all bad out there. It's just there are people sometimes where there's people, there's problems. Thank you all for tonight. Again, Jacob, great job, man. That was a great resource. You did a good job. And I really do appreciate it again from someone from another state. And the way this worked out, just to show the few that are left, I've been assisting Jacob with a college student initiative with shooting and stuff. And I asked him, I said, hey, you know, I'm trying to start this reciprocity where, you know, NC, me, the hunter engagement coordinator, does something, and I could use a hand with a Delta webinar, because the last time I had Delta involved with was in-person seminars, and I've had nothing since. And he said, yes, I would do it. So he did us a gracious favor and did a great job tonight. Thank you, Jacob.
Well, thanks for having me on, guys. If anybody has any kind of further questions, yeah, just please let me know.
Okay, Potter County PA veteran here. Oh, awesome. Great job tonight. Thank you, sir. That is the Allegheny Plateau, one of my favorite places in the world. And Cinema Honing's a favorite too. So nice to hear that. Always nice to hear folks. Okay, good night. Be ethical, be safe, and protect the resources, folks. And maybe I'll see you out there someday. Everybody have a great night. Good night, Jacob.
Night.